Hey guys, so if you're new here, or if you're not, if you want to hear me voice act, head over to our main channel, links down below. And if you don't, this channel's solely for TTS. If you want to know all the details about what's going on, we have a stream up that you can go and watch, but let's just get into the video.
Now to introduce the characters of this story, let's begin with the hacker. Real name, Ray Lau. Street name, Byte. Metatype, human. Byte wasn't even born when his parents were disowned by Wuxing and had to have their sins burned before a shattering team was sent to eliminate them. He and his older brother never learned the reason why, and Byte never cared. While his brother could adapt to the shadows and find use of his gifts, he himself never forgave his father and mother from failing to provide him the luxurious life he always desired. Now living in one of his older brother's hideout, he finds himself lacking the money to pay the next rent. He always had been envious of his brother's success at life in everything he does. When he could go and enjoy a rare sunny day during summer, Byte has to hide indoors because of his albinism. When his relative was invited to parties downtown, Byte stayed at home since he can't even talk to a girl without dropping his spaghetti. Now he has to do shadowing, where he is sure people will recognize him, track him and gut him down. And worst of all, he'll surely have to do stuff like crawl in sewers and filth. Negative quality. Albinish eye. Social stress. Distinctive style. Albinism. Poor self-control. He cannot support feeling dirty. Positive quality. Overcloaker. Perfect time. Codderslinger. Friend in high places. Second character. The one that I play. Real name. Nikos Galanis. Street name, Short Fuse. Metatype, Dwarf. Wide smile, worn out clothes and smelling of cheap booze, those could describe thousands of inhabitants living in the Redmond Barrens, but none exemplify it more than Nikos Galanis. While struggling to survive in the Barrens, Nikos awakened his magical potential, and guided by his spirit mentor Dionysus, he has made his life goal to improve the life in the Barrens for his community. Negative qualities. Signature, alcohol. Voluntarily or not, there would always be alcohol found wherever he goes on a run. I fluffed it as a way for him to cast his spells. Code of honor, children. Positive qualities. Legendary rep II Redmond commune. Trustworthy, can you really say no to a kind dwarf who offers you beer? Drug tolerant. Mentor spirit, Dionysus. Character 3. Real name, Pepper Allens. Street name, Dice. Metatype, Elf. Pepper was an orphan living in the streets when she was adopted by the professional assassin Deadline. Trained in the very basic ways of the ninja, he tasked his young protege to eliminate targets on a list, and finally himself. Just in case his student happened to chicken out, he injected her with a poison that would kill her in less than a year. Before he left, he gave all his possessions, which includes his armored car, his gadgets and his stealth gear to her in the hope she might actually succeed. Negative qualities. Phobia, thunder and lightning. Borrow time. Positive qualities, from what I remembered. Cat-like. Agile defender. Restricted gear. Last character. Real name, Harvey Hunt. Street name, Wolfhound. Metatype, Orc. Wolfhound always lived in the streets. He only knew the crumbling concrete, the smell of filth and the taste of blood. He never knew what was before he was rescued by the Wild Dogs gang. Apparently he was an engineered super soldier project from a corp the gang had raided. Personally, he felt he would have been better left there. The leader of the gang Apex is an insane toxic dog shaman, who treated him with cruelty. Now that he is out of the gang, with the cyberwares and biowares they paid for, he feels he can't take out anyone. I cannot remember all his qualities since he had a lot of them, but I know he had a fear of dogs. Doesn't feel sad for others, or feel disgust at all. Genetic stuff like biocompatibility and quick healer. When the player showed me his character sheet, I thought at first he made dervish because of the orc with spurs and rocket feet, but he told me he never read the story time, and only wanted an optimized street Sam. His final result is what he called the love child of Red Hood and Wolverine. Chapter 1, Taking Names and Kicking Asses. Our group has four now, mostly done games based around anime, like Fairy Tail and D&D. Fair warning, the game will have many anime references delivered by a bunch of young adults that could have spent that time socializing instead of watching said anime. All in all, it was a new experience for us. Well, except for me and the Grams. I had been waiting to do some Shadoran for a while, ever since I read the story time and played the video games, and he played the game once before. Thought he used the modules for stat blocks. I can't remember him actually playing one module. Except for Food Fight, right out of hell. The game began with Pepper, who didn't have a street name at the time. She was meditating on some rooftops at night. Her stomach was in knots. When she was saved by her master, she knew she was about to live the life of an assassin. She made peace with it. Hell, it's even easier when the other alternative is being gutted in an alleyway and have her organs be sold even before her corpse gets cold. From above, she looked at the streets. If she believed her contact, there's a man down there who knows where to find her but her targets. Problem is, he is aware she's after him and he's hiding inside a building. This is her one shot to get her hands on him and being one step closer to her goal, otherwise he'll hide somewhere else and it will become increasingly hard to find him. Near midnight, the man she was looking for showed up. Exiting of the coffin motel was a person circled by five other smaller guards. With the vision magnification on her mask, she recognized the target as a heavily cybered up troll, flanked with bikers from an unknown group. She was about to start the chase when something caught her attention. Down below her, an Ra's Roadmaster started its engine by itself. It would have been of no concern for her if that ride wasn't her own. Someone was about to run away with her wheels, but worst of all her braking and entering tools were left inside the car. Giving up on her chance at the informant, she jumped off the rooftop, deployed her wingsuit cape Batman style and chase after her Batmobile. Meanwhile, at a cheap garage in the Barrens, Bite was snickering to himself. After his older brother kicked him off the apartment for the night for lazing around all day, he was left with nothing much to do to kill time. When strolling around town, he happened to find an unoccupied and unguarded Ra's Roadmaster. With a mischievous grin, he hacked the car into the car. Inside, he was incredulous when he found out all the incredibly pricey gear that was left unattended, ripe for the taking. With a wicked glee only reserved for the most dickish of occasions, he decided that this van deserved some new mods and a new owner. Looking at the price of and availability of mechanic at this hour, he decided to go to a garage inside a recently founded commune in the Barrens. Wolfhound was dozing off in an alleyway, covered in blood. As a matter of fact, covered wasn't doing the scene justice. The ground, the walls, the thrash piles laying around, himself, everything was either covered in gore or with small chunky bits of what he assumed was people, with some having more fur than the others. He was bruised and tired, but he stood up nonetheless, with purpose. Those men he just killed belonged to the wild dogs. They send their hounds after him, they know he is afraid of them. When he got cornered, everything went red for him. It was do or die, fight or flight. He could have taken a moment to savor his handiwork. After all, it was less psychos on the streets, but he knew Apex could recruit dozens more degenerates like them. He only bought off time for himself. Or rather, Apex bought off time against him. He was about to leave when a homeless man walked into the alleyway. In front of the massacre, the man threw up. For what would be considered disturbing for most people, it barely affected Wolfhound, but he wasn't dumb enough to walk into the streets like he is right now. So with his spurs he cut off a fire hydrant and let the water rinse him. Before walking away from the scene, he looked at the hobo, asked him directions on where he could find job for a Shadowrunner. After being told about the new commune in the Barrens, he gave the man some new yens and went on his way. Her mentor has the antidote. She has to kill her mentor to get it. She could skip the other targets and head straight for him, but view it as a final boss in a video game. If she doesn't gain EXP by killing other bosses and doing missions, she won't be strong enough for the final fight. 75,891,046. It was also the GM's way to have Dice and Bite share their equipment at Jarjan. Dice had enough to buy the Ra's Roadmaster, and Bite used his remaining money to upgrade it. One condition is that we can't use the car before some time. GM wanted to see if we weren't too overpowered before giving us what amounts to a civilian tank. Nikos Galanis barely got any time to sleep that night. All day he helped at the soup kitchen providing meals for everyone. At 20h the commune's leader tasked with helping some folks with repairing the wall surrounding the commune. Then near 23h gangers attacked the commune and he had to fight for his life to protect children caught in between the firefights. Yearning for only his worn out mattress and bedsheets, he started walking in the direction of his home. But before he even had the time to open the door to his room, the commune's leader called him on his comlink about a new problem he has to fix. With a resigned sigh, Nikos opened up one of his many flasks hidden in his jacket, drank it whole, and head out to the leader's office. The leader of the Barons' commune was an old troll woman, with so many scars her face would look like minced meat under a low light. Her name was Hope. A long time ago, she ran the shadows, married a strong troll husband, had a dozen kids and lived happily raising them inside their small home. They used their unions to live a life free of the dangers of the streets and they prayed for a better future for their children. Unfortunately, it didn't happen. Tricked by a former teammate into running again, Hope's husband was sent to jail after the run went south, abandoned by his former team. With her man locked up, things started going downwards for Hope and her kids. Thugs were harassing the family, criminals started asking for protection fee and money was drying up. One day, unable to pay the crooks, one of Hope's sons was kidnapped as compensation. By the time she had enough money to save him, it was too late. He has been sold out to an organ legger. Her son, her own flesh and blood, killed and ripped apart for his body parts. Stealing her resolve, she took her family, bought all the weapons she could afford, trained her kin into using them and went into the Barons to start anew. When people learned of a gang establishing inside the Redmond that isn't about causing havoc, well, naturally they started congregating towards it. What started as a family of 10 grew into a gang of 30, then over 100, then over 1,000, to finally reached around the 5,000 that is today. All those people now were her new and extended family. They were all in her care, and now more than ever she will need all the help she can get to solve a crisis at hand. No tabletop RPG is complete without beautiful models on the table, and the best place to get models is from us. If you check the link below, we have everything you could need for your magical realm. Only the finest of big titty wafers here. But if you're not into models or don't play with models, we got you covered with subclasses such as the Gachimashi Wizards, the Simp Warlock and the North FC Fighter. Also, we have started selling 5th edition adventures with our first one featuring Belle Delphine, the succubus that has poisoned the town's well and turned the villagers into simps. If any of that stuff sounds fun to you, go ahead and check the link below, but let's get back to the video. In front of Hope's desk were standing 3 men and a girl. The orc had the distinct look of a born killer, with his jacket still smelling of fresh blood, his muscles ready for any sudden movement and his cyber eyes glowing red pointing towards her. The man standing on his left looked a bit off. By his feature he looks Asian, but with his skin and hair having the color of onion's milk. Except for his clothes looking too clean for where he was currently standing, nothing out of the ordinary came off of that guy. The third one standing in the middle was Nikos. The dwarf was a blessing for the community. Since they cannot afford to send everyone to the street doc when anyone gets hurt, most were sent to him first. He knew how to fight and how to repair the walls and barricade. He even cooks at the soup kitchen to help the staff. As a matter of fact, everything that he learned was for the community. She was really glad he came tonight despite working without rest all day. The last one was the oddest of the group. A young girl, not older than her cadet, was leaning towards the window in what Hope assumed was a pose to appear serious in front of her. She wasn't fond of sending youngsters do her dirty work, but this one was wearing highly illegal gear and seemed like she knew how to use it. Before she had the time to open up her mouth, the human spoke up. "Bite, so are you about to let me upgrade my wheels or not? It's not like I despise standing in this dreck, but I do. Hope, we can't open up the garage right now, not after the at. Bite, then let me take it back so I can get out of this rat nest." After the day she had and now having to worry about her crisis, clubbing the man to death seemed like a pretty tempting idea at this very moment. Knowing her boss was seconds away from wasting the guy, Nikos intervened. Nikos, look chumma, we understand your needs, but hope wouldn't prevent you from leaving with your car if it wasn't a dire situation. Bite, and why am I concerned again? Nikos, I see your ride when you came here. No one owning an RAS Roadmaster can't be of help to us right now. Well, honestly, we would take anyone. At the mention of her stolen vehicle, the young elf's face blushed with anger and she exploded with rage. Pepper, it was you. I chased you from half the town, you fraggin' sewer rat. I missed my man because of you. Bite, I'm pretty sure you can find plenty of men everywhere, Dandelion Eater. Just set your date on Earth. His sentence was abruptly cut short when the girl's fist hit his jaw. She didn't have the time to land another punch as the imposing orc stood between her and the man lying on the ground. Without batting an eye, but with a small smirk on the side of her face, Hope decided to ask the strangers for help. Hope, look, I know you all have your differences, but I need you all right now. It's not something I can ask of anyone since our defenses are too thin. She took a long pause, inspecting everyone in the room. Her poker face was slightly shaking as she herself was finally realizing right now what happened. As if a nightmare she had a long time ago was waking up her at this very moment. Hope, I want to ask of you to rescue my daughter, Moxie. The biker gang who invaded us an hour ago took my only daughter as hostage. They want me to surrender the whole commune to them before dawn, or else they'll start chopping her bits by bits and send them to me each hour after sunrise. The troll woman was starting to lose composure. She lost one child already, and it was too much for her. If Moxie happened to die, she would surely fall apart. Pepper seemed eager to accept Hope's cry for help. Wolfhound in his case was considering if he should take the job or not, but was it really a job if it was a mother's request? He really didn't feel like risking his life for a kiss on the cheek by an old troll woman and a pat on the back by some hobos. Bite was feeling the same but was pretty more vocal about it. Bite, and what do we get out of this? You lock up M. her van and expect me to do charity afterwards? Everyone was looking apprehensively at Hope after what Bite said. Some of them wanted to help, but they were still mercenaries after all. After a few seconds that felt like minutes, the commune's leader plunged her hand under the desk and took out a gold cred stick. Hope, in this there's 8,000 nuyens for every one of you. Kill the bikers and get my daughter back to me in one piece. I'm ready to offer up 2,000 extra if you plant this. She then took out what looked like a makeshift bomb inside their hideout. I've heard that the center pillar on the last floor is vulnerable. If you blow up their base, it will send a message to not mess with us. Wolfhound took the bomb and stuffed it under his arm. He looked at Hope and asked a single question. Wolfhound, where can we find the gang? Hope, it's 10 blocks away down the street, straight line, with the blue and white graffitis. You can't miss it. You can walk up there in 10-20 minutes. Wolfhound, you'll have your daughter in 30. And without another word he left, he lit a cigar and went on his way. The other runners would have liked to at the very least exchange each other's name before engaging into this mission, but the street Sam had no time to waste. Waiting for no one, not giving a dreck about silly things like planning and strategy, the orc Sammy was only one block away from the biker's hideout before he was stopped by Nikos. Nikos, are you crazy? Think with your gray matter, not your chrome. We know jack dreck about those guys. Do you even know where Moxie is holed up? What kind of guards are near the last floor pillar? Even better. Were you intending on running gun blazing into the free with a fraggin' bomb under your arm? Wolfhound made a short pause, took into consideration what the dwarf said and realized he could use the help for this one. Next to the building a plan was formed. Taking out a cyber deck from a duffel bag, the decker jacked into VR. Not long after the comlinks of everyone on the team, including Wolfhound Sibberies, plus his and Pepper's mask were connected to the new team's hacker. The icon of a sharp-teeth jaw started appearing, numbing away all kind of protection the runners' gadgets had, replacing it by a more secure line. Bite, listen up you sorry band of fuck-ups. Name's Bite. I'm not interested in learning your name, and couldn't care less if you die during this. I've been looking around here in the Matrix. Those guys got some turrets ready around and cameras. The girl's on the second floor, with two men guarding her. They seem to have covered the windows on that floor too. Last floor above though seems to be empty. Nikos, we could send someone to up there to eliminate the guards below, even plant the bomb. Wolfhound, I can hear what they say with my mask. Doesn't seem like they know we're about to hit M. Interesting. One of them complained about the trap they set up on the first floor's stairs. Bite, did they say what it is? Wolfhound, nope. The dude only said it was a pain to get to the shitters because of it. Bite, can't see it on my screen. Well, screw it, nobody's allowed upstairs that way. Am I making myself clear, you chucklefucks? Pepper, no one said you were the boss. Bite, and no one would listen if you were the boss, knife ears. The girl infiltrator was about to find a clawful insult to address the Decker, but she picked up an unusual sound on her heavily modified headphones. Pepper, wait, I'm hearing strange sounds. Like scratching. And growling? From below. Do you hear it, Sammy? Wolfhound, can't say I do. What do you think, Bite? Bite, it could be a devil rat's for what I know. There's some everywhere in the poor quarters. Wolfhound, you know what to do against those? Bite, those are poor people problem. Do I like a hobo to you? Wolfhound, forget I ask. While the others were talking, Nikos had the time to summon a 4-6 air spirit. It took the form of a giant eagle made of wind, with two miniature suns for eyes. Nikos, I'm ready for a fight, though I only have one service for my spirit. I'd rather keep it in case things go south. Pepper pointed her grapple gun towards the building's roof, ready and awaiting instructions. Bite, here's how we're going to do this. I hack the turrets and cams, turn them against the bikers. Meanwhile, the tree hugger and the short stack go up the roof, plant the bomb, free the girl and get out. You there, big guy, when the Drekshaw starts, you go in and kill everyone. Am I making myself clear? Everyone, yes. They had the perfect plan. They were synchronized. They were well equipped. They were ready. Wolfhound was standing in ambush awaiting the turrets turning to their side before moving. Pepper and Nikos were climbing the side of the building using the grapple gun. But there was one thing they didn't account for. The shaman never trained in his life in stealth. Even worse, he forgot to use his invisibility spell. When they arrived on the second floor, the dwarf nearly let go of the infiltrator. Gripping as strong as he could, he couldn't refrain himself from saying aloud, "Oh, Drek," as he nearly fell two stories high to the concrete ground. The thugs inside heard him loud and clear. They're here. Kill those fuckers. Turrets or not, Wolfhound was not going to let them organize themselves and get the upper hand. Activating the skinners and hydraulic jacks on his saber legs, he rocketed into the hideout, claws out like Wolverine. Rural is a great app available on the Apple and Google Play Store as well as desktop for creating beautiful 8-bit character art. The app has 14 supported races, 150 plus weapons, 400 plus armor pieces for you to mix and match, 20 plus mini bases. There is that much to work from. I was able to make Coldsteel the Hedgehog, the God Emperor of Mankind, Pepe, and they are always adding more artwork. The app also has a character sheet to help keep track of everything during games. And if that wasn't enough, you can play about with the app for free with limited artwork. So go ahead, check it out, and if you decide to buy the app, use promo code NICKBEDIA for 10% off and it lets them know we sent you. It's a great sponsor and a great app and we hope you guys go ahead and check it. But let's get back to the video. I think the GM took inspiration from Jason Todd stealing the wheels from the Batmobile. Can't say for certain though. Firearms were shot, bloody limbs flew everywhere and a lot of scream were heard that night. Bite managed to get the turrets under control, but by the time he did it, the street Sam received one or two bullets. He didn't seem to mind, but in case he complains, Bite was about to blame it all on the dwarf. When Nikos and Pepper arrived at the third floor, they were welcomed with the barrels of semi-auto. Fortunately, they were aiming at Pepper and she managed to dodge the shots. She answered in kind by whipping out a monofilament whip, tearing one of her opponent's arm off, quickly followed by his head. Even if it was pretty gruesome, the display impressed the dwarf shaman. Seizing an opportunity to amaze someone, Pepper tried to do one of those sword slash you see in anime that are too quick for the eyes and cut the enemy into 100 cubes of flesh. She had a critical glitch. Normally with monofilament whips, when you make a critical glitch you would hit yourself with one of the nastiest weapon in the game. Since it was our first game and also a performance check, it was decided that she just cut the guy apart and she would be lashing against the corpse trying to dice it up. Instead of looking like a badass in front of Nikos, she looked like Pick-related. On the first floor, after the last biker was dealt with, something caught the attention of Wolfhound. Near the center of the whole floor, where were posting the turrets, was a bunch of wooden planks recovering what seemed like a giant hole. And now sounds were coming off that hole. It was getting louder by the minute. With horror he realized that what the team mistook for devil rats were in fact feral ghouls, and they were breaking apart the cheap barricade. His first reflex was to close the door on the first floor. If the ghouls managed to exit the building, they will avern the team in seconds. He was about to plan his next move when he heard this exchange through his comlink. Nikos, guys, I made a mistake. Bite, what do you mean you made a mistake? Pepper, he accidentally switched the timer on the bomb from 1 minute to 10 seconds. Bite, you fraggy. Wolfhound, you guys evac, now. Pepper, what abo? Wolfhound, evac, now. The ferals had broken the barrier and were swarming the first floor. Taking no time for safety, Wolfhound ran past the horde with his rocket legs, climbed the stairs and triggered the trap. It was some grenades pinned with trip wires, but by the time it was going off he was already gone. And the building too. With no time to spare, he grabbed the young troll girl on the ground of the second floor and jumped through a window. With his hydraulic jacks he didn't fear falling from height, and it was just what he needed in this situation. First thing he did when he touched the ground was running. Then he ran some more. Carrying Moxie on his back, he sprinted directly to the commune. He didn't bother to slow down in case debris would fall on him. All he was sure is that he need to bring Hope's daughter as soon as possible. After all he said 30 minutes, he's got his cred on the line. While the building is falling apart, in the sky there were two figures flying. The first was a dwarf using his 4-6 air spirit to carry him to the commune. The second was the infiltrator, using her wingsuit cape, she batman away into the night, direction the commune. Safe from the failing debris, but not from the settling dust, Bite jacked out of VR with cold hatred in what bottomless pit serves as a heart. Not only did the dwarf fucked up twice, almost killing the objective. But worst of all, now his whole clothes are covered in dust. He would have went back home immediately to clean himself if it were not for the prospect of the Nuyans and possible running water at the commune. When they arrived at the commune, and everyone was greeting them with cheers and happiness. This has been their first major victories against criminal gangs in years, and the biggest up to date since the commune's creation. Men, women and children were celebrating. Inside Hope's office were a newly formed team of Shadowrunners along with their employee and her daughter. Hope, I cannot thank you enough for what you have done. Rather, we at the commune cannot thank you enough for today. Pepper, all cheerily after completing her first run, it was a pleasure. Nikos, satisfied as always to have helped his community, you can always count on me, Hope. Wolfhound, pretty neutral, but with a slight grin, it was pretty nice. Bite, and caring for the thanks of hobos, and not giving a fuck, give us the Nuyans. Hope pulled out from under the table the cred stick she had shown earlier and gave it to Bite, but not before giving the team an opportunity. Hope, you know, you did great for us today. And with your help we could all reach new heights. Are you willing to let me become your fixer for your team? Nikos, gladly, becoming a runner, that's quite exhilarating. Count me in. Pepper, uncertain but still on board, I have my own goals you know, so I'm not sure if I'll be always there. But this does seem like a good workout. Wolfhound considered for an instant if being an actual runner would benefit his quest on taking out Apex. After what he did to those last men, at the bikers today, it has become apparent that things will escalate. He knew Apex, even if totally insane, still had enough reason to build and expand his criminal empire like no one else. For now he will join this team, just to see if he can eventually do it alone. Plus running would bring some cash he desperately need. Wolfhound, I accept. Bite, what do you think will make me want to stay with those dumbasses? Wolfhound, if we the Decker that replaces you isn't good at his job, we'll send him your way for training. At your expenses, of course. Bite, what makes you think I'll allow you to do that? Wolfhound, smugly, because otherwise I'll spend my entire shattering career ruining your existence. Bite, fuck you. I accept. Hope smiled with content, then clapped her hands together. With a wink she addressed one last point before letting the runners go home. Hope, now that I think about it, I haven't learned your names, nor have we discussed your street names. Wolfhound, Wolfhound's my name. Haven't got any other one. I did manage to get my hand on a fake sin, Harvey Hunt it says. Hope, then Wolfhound is your street name, and Harvey Hunt will be your real name. Bite, before you say anything, name's Bite, and I'm not going to tell you my real name. Hope, a bit flustered over Bite's attitude, fine. What about you, young miss? Pepper, I thought about Pepper, since it's my name and I have pepper punch grenades and owls. Nikos with a smugly face, I say dice. Pepper, and sure, why is that? Then the dwarf proceeded to tell everyone in the room how the elf infiltrator acted like a cute little psycho just to show off her skills. Her face was blushed by embarrassment was getting redder by the minute. Hope, who's not sure between giggling or being worried, well by itself dice sounds like a pretty nice street name. Wolfhound, and if people knows why we call you dice they might actually drag their pants. I call that a win. Pepper was too shy to say anything, but a part inside her relished the appeal of her new street name. Nikos, satisfied that the team chose his pick was about to speak up his street name when a shit-eating grin Bite interrupted him. Bite, and you'll be named Short Fuse. Nikos, what? Why? Bite, his grin ever expanding, because first, you nearly blew us up, and second only me can insult everyone with impunity. Take it or leave, Short Fuse. The second he said that it became his whole objective to not lose face. The GM was actually impressed we got the best results out of the worst situation. And thus ends the first chapter of Shadowrun Tale. Well guys, hope you enjoy today's video. We are going to assume you have if you have stayed to the end. Consider subscribing and clicking the notification bell if you really enjoyed it to stay up to speed with any and all new videos. Also check out the links below to our shop for some fat ass titties and our sponsor Rural, and be sure to use a promo code at checkout so they know we sent you and you'll get 10% off. And until next time.